Hello everyone, welcome to another lecture of Digital Signal Processing. In today's class, we are going to see how to use DFT as a convolution property and also how to efficiently and fastly compute your discrete Fourier transform. So these are the two topics we are going to see, and all of which leads to simplification of DFT. So if I have to summarize today's class in just one sentence, we're going to see how we simplify DFT using its properties in order to make it more faster and more efficient. Good. So let's get started. So today what I have written here is a recap from previous class. So in previous lecture, I have told you how to use DFT as your linear transform. That is what I have done here. And now what I would like to tell you, or what I would like to do here, is I'm going to take this Wn, which is the substitution for e to the power of minus j 2 pi by n. And now the next step I'm going to do is, after that substitution, I'm writing this in a matrix form. So when I do that, it's going to simplify my computation a bit, because solving linear system of equations are considered to be much complex than doing matrix computations. So representing it in a matrix form, or representing our DFT in a matrix form, which is a much simpler way to do the computation. Good. So I'm doing a bit of reordering to make it matrix multiplication compatible. We'll see more on this. And next, for the IDFT, which is shown on your right hand side, you have in matrix form, you are writing it as x of n is equal to xn Wn inverse. So here we have an inverse matrix, and we all know that finding the inverse of a matrix is not so straightforward. However, in DFT, we do have the option of writing the inverse as a complex conjugate, not because we like to, but because the matrix W, or the matrix associated with the inverse, is a orthogonal unilateral matrix. Unitary matrix, you can say orthogonal unitary transformation, and we don't want to do much on the proof for that. I'm just going to say that my Wn inverse is equal to Wn conjugate in this case, and that is how your computation gets simpler. So what are the simplifications we have done to DFT so far since its original equations that we have seen? The first simplification is to use substitution W for e to the power of minus j 2 pi by n. And for your second simplification is your matrix form representation. And now what next? So the next simplification that we do have is, we are going to use the symmetry and the periodicity property for any signal, which is also applicable to our Wn. So we are going to simplify some of the terms that comes in your DFT in this manner. So for my periodicity property, I'm going to write my Wn of k plus n is equal to Wn of k. And for my symmetry property, it's given as Wn of k plus n by 2 is equal to minus n Wn of k. So what it means is, my signal repeats after every n points or n samples. So which means, if I take a signal of duration n samples starting from the origin point, I'm going to get the same signal. So that is what my first periodicity property states. The second periodicity property states that every half, so my signal is of length n, so every n by 2, after every n by 2 point, my signal is going to be the negative of the values, right? So the negative, the values are going to be negative, so which means these are, we can call it anti-symmetric, but that is how we get it and how the proof is written here. The periodicity proof is very straightforward. We don't need to prove it. But for symmetry, let us just substitute for Wn, that is e to the power of minus j 2 pi by n. And then we expand it for k plus n by 2 and then see what you get. You get it as minus e to the power of minus j 2 pi by n k, which is minus Wn to the power k. So that proves your symmetry property, and proof for periodicity is very straightforward. We don't have to do, because any multiples of n, e to the power of j multiple of n is going to be 1, right? So that is understood. So I'm just going to write this is coming from the periodic repetition here. All right. So that is your third simplicity, which is periodicity and symmetry. And now we will see an example on how all this put together can simplify your computation of DFT to a whole another level of. Right, so how do we do this? So let us see an example. First, we write a W4 to the power of 5. So it is a 4-point sequence, but it is I'm getting the power 5. So I can write it in W4 to the power of 1 plus 4. Right, so that is equal to W4 to the power of 1. So this is using periodicity property. We just seen now. Next, we have W4 to the power of 3, which is equal to W4 to the power of 1 plus 2, which is equal to minus W4 to the power of 1. That is using your symmetry property, where my 2 is here equal to k plus 1. So that is your symmetry property and your periodicity property. So now I can, what I can do is, now any given any point, so if I want to find any DFTs, now my programming, even writing my program in my computer, becomes a whole lot easier when I do this for, you know, W and I use this periodicity property. So which means whenever I'm getting any value greater than 4, I can simplify it because it's a periodic notation, and this becomes a lot easier in your computation, right? So, and it is, this is also a faster way, because W to the power of 5 computing and W to the power of 1 is exponentially faster than W to the power of 5. So your computation speed improves, and this is why, you know, this W factor or the W substitution is widely used in your Fourier transform or fast Fourier transform, which we are going to see in the coming lectures. Now I want to write a 4-point WN matrix, so which means I'm going to write it as W to the power of kn, W4 to the power of kn, and my k is represented in the horizontal axis and my n is represented on the vertical axis. Good. So now W4 into kn is given in this manner. Good. So I am just substituting the values of kn n to the power of W4. So I get my 16 values in this manner, and now I can simplify this using the symmetry and the periodicity property. We can do this, and then I will get a 4x4 matrix, which is going to be a lot simpler matrix, which can be easily remembered, and I can do this for any number, right? So here we have done it for just 4. I can do this for 5-point, I can do this for 6-point, I can do this for 8-point, I can do this for even, you know, any number of points. If it is in a computer program, it's easily scalable. So now I'm simplifying this further. So my first row and the first column becomes all W0, because in one of the rows my n is 0, and for one of the columns my k value is 0. So the other values are 1, 2, 3. So I don't want to do anything with 1, 2, 3, because they are part of my 4-point sequence. So for my 4-point sequences are 0, 1, 2, and 3. So I don't want to do anything with those exponentials. But for higher than 3, you can see I'm getting 4, 6, and 9. It is very easy to apply the periodicity property. W4 of 4 is equal to 0. W4 of 6 is equal to W4 of 2. And W4 of 9 is equal to, it is having two periods, right? 8, 4 plus 4, 8, 8 plus 1, 9. So that is W4 of 1. Excellent. So using periodicity property, I have simplified everything to less than W4 of 3. And now I can easily compute these values. W4 of 0 is e to the power of 0. That's going to be 1. W4 of 1 is going to be e to the power of minus j pi by 2. That is minus j. And W4 to the power of 2 is going to be pi, and that's going to be 1. minus 1 and then plus j. So I know these values W40, W41, W42, W43. Now I can write my W4 4-point DFK matrix in this form. Good. So this is now a very simple matrix. I want you to remember this matrix because this makes your DFT computation so much easier, less error prone. So if you're doing this on a pen and paper using a linear system of equations, you must be looking at four big equations in your paper right now and solving them. You could, you know, make mistakes at various places and you may never end up getting the right answer. But now see how simple your DFT computation has become. You just have to take this 4x4 matrix and multiply it with your input sequence, and that gives you your DFT matrix. Good. Now what about the inverse DFT matrix? So this is WN, and what is the inverse we have seen? The inverse is given by 1 by N WN conjugate. So I have to do the complex conjugate of this matrix W4, and my complex conjugate is nothing but what? What do I do? I just put my value of J to be minus J and my minus J to be plus J. So this is your value of your complex conjugate. Good. So you remember W4, you can easily come up with W4 conjugate. And if you want in exam, if you want to do W5, you can just simply do this and compute it. This I would suggest, you know, using this method over any other method for computing DFT in your exams or in any of the questions where you have to use your pen and paper to solve this kind of question. So now I have an example question for you. Compute your 4-point DFT and IDFT for x of n, which is equal to 1010. So I have purposefully selected a simple sequence so that I don't have to do a lot of multiplication and addition on this board here. So I just wanted to show the steps. How do I do this? How do I do this? I write my W4 because it's a 4-point DFT. I write my W4, which I have just found previously. I'm going to write that matrix right here, and then I x of n is written as a transpose 1010. And then it is left only the matrix multiplication. How do I do that? The first row into first column, second row, first column always. So I'm writing the steps here. I'm pretty sure all of you who are watching this knows how to do matrix multiplication. So I'm not enlisting the steps here. So you get this 2020. All right, good. And that is your DFT. See how simple it is, how simple your finding DFT is. And now next, you have to find your IDFT. In order to do that, I'm going to write my conjugate matrix. Right, so I know my conjugate matrix. So what I'm going to do is I'm not going to find the DFT of 1010. I'm going to find the DFT. I'm not going to find the IDFT of my x of n. I'm going to find the IDFT of my DFT. So I'm going to write my 1 by n WN conjugate, that is 1 by 4 into WN conjugate. I'm going to write in this manner, and that is added into my 2020. Good. So what do I get? So I have to, again, I will do the substitution. I will do the computation for you. So just so that it is clear, and I also want to highlight one more step for you. So I am going to get something like this. So now what I would like you to see from this is the number of multiplications and additions. So that is the next bottleneck or the next disadvantage we have with our discrete Fourier transform, which we are going to see in the next topic of today's class. So you can see that we are requiring a total of 16 multiplications, right? 16 multiplications for DFT and around 12 addition subtractions. So you can, additions or subtractions, they are considered as both addition and subtraction, and that is going to be 12 additions and subtractions. So just remember this one. And now if you see the IDFT value is 1010, so which means my x of n taken DFT gives x of k. And x of k when applied IDFT gives me my x of n. So I'll just write here my 16 multiplications and 12 additions. So just so that you know that is how many and how we get those numbers. It's very obvious. You can count it and see, and you write it here. Good. So that is for, no, that is it, no, that is what we are going to take over for the next class. And before that, we would like to see how to do your DFT filtering, how to do circular convolution. So you have seen, most of you who have taken signals and systems classes must have seen your linear convolution, and which means it is used mostly for the filtering of sequences. I can just say that much. But now we are going to see circular convolution, and why we are seeing circular convolution here is because the circular convolution is a property of DFT, and it is a derivative of discrete Fourier transform. So the circular convolution is derived from your DFT, and then it is applicable to mostly periodic sequence, because when we are wrapping a signal in the form of a circle, it's just like you take an example of your clock. So in your clock, the needle goes round every hour, it comes to the same position, and that is your periodic, right? A circular convolution is something of the same manner. We are writing the sequence in the form of a circle, in the shape of a circle, and doing the computation, which means this is applicable mostly to your periodic sequence, and it means, right, your signal is repeating after that circular period. So one circle represents one period of your signal, and that is the meaning of using a circular convolution. So a circular convolution can be effectively used to filter two sequences which are periodic in nature, both of which must be periodic. So in that case, you don't have to do, you can take one period of one signal and the second period of one signal, you do the convolution, and then you make that convolution output periodic, and that is going to be your circular convolution output. Okay. So now let us see a simple proof, because the proof is little complex, little bit difficult in terms of the steps involved, but I'll do it in a very simple manner here for your understanding. So I have a sequence x1 which is giving my DFT x of k and x2 of k, and my third sequence is x3 of n, which is given by x3 of k. Right, I'm writing the IDFT formula here, look carefully, and my x3 of k is my x1 into x2. So the assumption is the circular convolution formula is derived from the multiplication of Fourier transform. So that is the assumption we are going with, right? Circular convolution is obtained by multiplication of two DFTs, x1 of k and x2 of k. So now I'm going to write the formula for x1 of k, that is your DFT formula. What is the DFT formula for x1 of k? It is given by x1 of n e to the power of minus j 2 pi by n k n, and my DFT for x2 of k is given by x2 of l e to the power of minus j 2 pi by n k n. So I'm using three notations, k, n, and l. Good. And three variables, m, n, and l. So if you see, these are the different variables, m, l, and n, and this is used in purpose, so we don't want the same, it doesn't have to be the same indexing, so we just use different variables so that we can show how this gets simplified in the complex exponential. So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to regroup things. So I'm writing sigma n equal to 0 to n minus 1, sigma l equal to 0 to n minus 1. So I'm taking my x1 l and x2 l to one side, and then I'm left with only the complex exponential, and that is what I want, and I need a summation to associate with my complex exponential. I'm going to take the summation term k, because that k term has no role in my m minus l minus l. Good. So I'm taking the variable, I'm taking the summation k, just so that I can represent this formula. I can write it as sigma k a to the power of k, and that is equal to n when a is equal to n. So now by what it means is, I'm putting my a is equal to my complex exponential, and my a is 1 only when my m minus l minus n is a multiple of n. Good. That is a only time, that is the only time when I get this form e to the power of j 2 pi k into an integer, and that is the only place where I get my a to be equal to 1. And when that A is equal to 1, and that is the only case we are interested in, we are not interested in the other case of 1 minus AN divided by 1 minus A. I will just presume that that is going to be almost close to 1, or you know, it is going to be 0. Let us just say as the second term is more of interest, because it becomes close to 0, because A becomes close to 1. So we are not interested in the second term. We are interested in the first term. That gives sigma k equal to 0 to n minus 1 a to the power of k is equal to n. All right, good. So we will take this to the next step. So now my exponential, my complex exponential has reduced to a variable n. Yes, so that will take care of this 1 by n I have on the left hand side. But let me write the summation, the rest of the two summations. So I have no two summations, right? So sigma k has vanished, but I am still having my sigma n and sigma l. So this is what I can, you know, this is the simplified, where m minus n minus l is equal to multiple of n. So it is an integer multiple of n, and that is what makes it 1, and that is what gives me this n. So now I can write, from this I have to get rid of one more summation l. So I can write my l is equal to m minus n minus pn, or this is the formula, this is the mathematical formula for m minus n modulus n. So what is your m minus n mod n? So your m minus n mod n is nothing but the remainder. So what you do is, when you take the difference m minus n and you divide it by n, what is the remainder? So that is what your m minus n mod n means. So I'll write, so x1 of n, x2 of m minus n mod n. So this is good. Like, this is now your circular convolution formula. So again, your modulus n is just remainder. So 2 by 4, what is the remainder? 2. 3 by 4, the remainder is 1. 4 by 4, the remainder is 0. 1 by 4, the remainder is 3. So that is basically what your modulo n means, but it is not that much details are not required. So I am not going in depth, but this derivation for circular convolution is something, it's very useful. It has been asked in some of the exams, some of the written tests for your exams, and also for some of the government sector exams, where you know you are asked to find the circular convolution formula. Now the given formula here, we can solve this formula using three methods: concentric circle, matrix multiplication, and your DFT multiplication. So the concentric circle method is what we will be seeing first, and the next followed by the matrix multiplication method. So let me write the steps for your concentric circle method. So it's very simple. If you follow these steps, write the first sequence in anti-clockwise direction. So with this concentric circle method, the way you write the sequence and how you rotate the sequence, it's of prime importance, because if you go wrong with that, your entire convolution output gets messed up. So you don't want that. So you need to follow these steps. So the second step is, write the second sequence in clockwise direction. So which is your first sequence and which is your second sequence, it doesn't matter. Whichever you select as your first sequence, that is your first sequence, and which you select as your second is going to be your second sequence. And now the order, you know, it's totally up to you, but once you decide on certain the sequence to be the first sequence, then you don't make it a second sequence in the later part of the calculations, and that will again lead to erroneous output. So you don't want to do that. So you fix at the beginning of the question solving, you fix which is going to be your first sequence and which is going to be your second sequence. And after that, what you need to do is these steps 3 and 4. You need to multiply and add to get the first convolution value, and then you need to shift the inner circle. So when I am saying inner circle, I'm talking about the second sequence, which is in clockwise direction. Shift the inner circle in anti-clockwise direction to get your second, third, and fourth convolution values. All right. So this is how you do your circular convolution. And a point to be noted, which has to be written, I should have written this point in the first, that is, if your sequence is not of the same length, what you do is you pad zeros and make it to be the same length. So if the question is, So we are going to do a bunch of numericals. So we'll do at least 10 numericals on this unit as a whole. So I would like to discuss, and I'll show you these examples. So if your sequence are not of the same length and the question says find your circular convolution, all you need to do is pad zeros, you append zeros to the shorter sequence, the shorter length sequence, and make it equal length to the bigger sequence or the longer sequence. Got it? So just pad zeros, make both the sequence to be of same length, and then you can compute. So now I have two sequence. For my anti-clockwise outer circle is my ABCD, and my inner circle clockwise is 1, 2, 3, 4. And that is going to give my x1 of n into x2 of 0 minus n modulo 4. That is a circular convolution formula. Then that is going to be the first convolution value, and for the second convolution value, I am shifting the inner circle anti-clockwise. So I have written that anti-clockwise shift I have shown for just 1, which is my x2 of 1 minus n mod 4. So these are the first and the second convolution. Now let's get with an example. So let's go to this example and see how this circular convolution is done. And that should clear you on, you can do circular convolution for n sequence, you can do for 8-point, you can do for 5-point, you can do for 6-point. So we have in exams, all kind of questions asked, but be careful. All the procedures, 4 steps that I have listed in the previous slide is the same to be followed for any, regardless of the number of sequence or the length of sequence, So the number of sequence will be always 2. When it gets more and more lengthier, it could get tricky in writing these numbers and solving it. So I would prefer, if you have a choice, go with matrix multiplication method, which is less, always matrix methods are less prone to error when you do on pen and paper. So now for this concentric circle solving, I'm having my 4 values I'll be getting because it's a 4-point sequence. And my first is my outer circle is written in my anti-clockwise, right? And my inner circle is written in my clockwise. And then I multiply and I get my value x3 of 1 is equal to 14. And then I shift for my second value, I shift my inner circle anti-clockwise. So I shift it anti-clockwise and I get the value 16. So my first sequence is, so x1 of n is the outer circle, and that's going to stay the same for all 4 convolutions, and only the inner circle is where we are shifting, and that is your x2 of n. And the first case it's going to be x2 of 0 minus n mod 4, x2 of 1 minus n mod 4, x2 of 2 minus n mod 4, and x2 of 3 minus n mod 4. So your mode is just a reminder, right? So what is a reminder when you do 2 divided by 4, the remainder is 2. 4 divided by 4, remainder is 0. 3 divided by 4, the remainder is what? 3. Yes. So I'm only discussing the positive modulus. The negative modulus is a little more tricky, but yes. So on a need to basis, we will see all these things. So for now, you need to know this much on how to do circular convolution, how to prove the circular convolution as a multiplication of DFT. That is what we have seen. The previous derivation and this solution is giving you here. Good. So you can see like each inner circle is shifted in anti-clockwise. And now if after the fourth circulation, if I do one more shift, I get to this position, right? One more shift will make it as 1, 2, 3, 4. And that is going to be the same as my first concentric circle. So if I do my x1 of n into x2 of 4 minus n mod 4, that is going to be the same as x1 of n and x2 of 0 minus n mod 4. Because my 4 by 4, 4 modulo 4 remainder is 0. Good. So that takes care of the concentric circle method. And now we are looking at your circular convolution as a matrix multiplication. So x3 of m is equal to sigma n equal to 0 to m minus 1. This is the formula for your circular convolution, m minus n mod n. Now what we want to do, what we like to do is, rather than doing this concentric circle method, which is also efficient, but you are not going to write a program for drawing circles and to do this on the computer. You cannot write a program, and if you want to do something on your computer, it has to be either in the form of 1D or 2D array. Okay, so you have n by n, n by 1, and n by 1, and now you have this as the matrix form for your circular convolution. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to take the same sequence which we have seen in the previous example, x1 and x2, and then I'm going to write it as 1, 2, 3, 4, right? I'm going to write it in an n by n matrix form. So that is my 4 by 4 matrix form. And how I'm doing this is I'm doing the cyclic shift. So if you see here, my 1, 2, 3, 4 is my input sequence. And then the rest three rows, my 4, 1, 2, 3, 3, 4, 1, 2, 2, 3, 4, 1 are the shifted. They are the shifted versions of my 1, 2, 3, shifting by one place, right? Shifting from left to right in one place. So you can, you can correlate to however, whichever makes sense to you, either in that manner or in my case, I just take the last element comes first in each of the rows. So my 4, which was the last element, comes to the first, and 3 comes here and 2 comes here. So this is one way I do it. Right, I remember this for each of the shift. And now I can compute with the help of 2, 1, 2, 1. And then I get my 14, 16, 14, 16, which is your circular convolution using matrix. And I strongly suggest if the question don't say, which method to use, go with the matrix method. That is the most simplest method. The third method, which is I'm not part of the syllabus and I'm not going to go into it right now. But I can quickly tell you that this is, convolution in time domain is equal to the multiplication in frequency domain, and x3 of m is equal to given by your. So I'm going to find this by taking the IDFT, right? I'm going to take, how do you solve it using FTS? I'm taking the DFT of x1 of n, I'm taking the DFT of x2 of n, I'm taking the DFT of these two sequences, multiply them, and take the inverse discrete Fourier transform. So when I take the inverse discrete Fourier transform, then that becomes your x3 of m.